in this edition of Art Loft, art inspired by revitalization.
There's so many things about my work that I think I'm still exploring. Some things that are very scientific, some things that are personal.
Miami Generation, 30 years after Exile.
It seems like when people think of Cuba and Cuban art, they always think that they're going to be looking at still lifes of mangoes.
And glass in the garden.
What makes his medium, which is glass, so wonderful within a garden setting is that it's very malleable. It's very soft. Glass is not soft, but the forms themselves can be very soft.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from Kavachnina Contemporary in the Wynwood Arts District, this is Art Loft. The Artist Transformation Series in Opa-Locka, Florida is an annual celebration of urban and civic renewal. This year, the celebration evolved into a month-long event steeped in the arts. Join us as we visit the In Plain Sight exhibition to speak to contributing artists about their work and its place in community redevelopment.
This landscape that's in Opa-Locka, given its history, creates a sense of place that is specific to a moment in history and yet is very present in today's, in our everyday existence. And so I was thinking about what it means to be visible and to be invisible in relationship to geography, in relationship to identity, in relationship to, you know, just everyday life. And so hence the title, In Plain Sight.
This show is about the Opa-Locka community and bringing the art to the community. I appreciate that the In Plain Sight show is about revitalization in a very practical and real way. There's so many things about my work that I think I'm still exploring. Some things that are very scientific, some things that are personal. You'll see play between figuration and abstraction, where you can choose as the viewer which way to interpret what you're seeing. If you're seeing a figure that's at the end of its life cycle, if it's in demise, or if it's reviving itself and rejuvenating itself, coming back to life. These are things I'm interested in. Both of these pieces are meant to be monuments that are in turmoil.
There's a sense that the figure or the face is kind of constructed from multiple pieces of paper. And so you get the sense of wholeness, but there's also the sense of sort of parts, you know, which talks about, you know, the individual and the community.
But this is what I call sacred geometry. It's about fractals. It's about self-similar images and repeating them over and over. And also, more importantly, I think it speaks to a new consciousness. The way I put these elements together is relatively simple. I start off with the basic photograph, and I start off with the portrait. All of these, for me, are portraitures. So I've been shooting people on black velvet backgrounds ever since I was in high school, and I will continue to do that with one light. And that's the first step. After I shoot the people, then we go into post, and then I look through the images and decide on which ones I want to work with. At which point, they're cut out with a pen tool in Photoshop, and then the games begin. Yeah. And it's whether you flip it this way, do that, double lip, you know, pop, 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 cut it here, this, that, and the next thing. And as I said, there is no script, there is no outline. It happens in the moment also, too. For me, it's very much about allowing the photograph to sort of manifest itself because it comes from a pure place. is not coming from a place of contrived or marketing or this, that, and next thing. None of that's involved. To be able to show the human body in different configurations that may be completely out of this world, I don't know where it's going to go. So each piece is a journey unto itself. And that's a beautiful thing. I really hope that when people look at these images, it stops them and gets them out of their head. If I can do that for even a second, then I say that I'm successful with these images.
I'm always trying to think about an artist in conversation with another. You know, what does this one bring to the table? And how does this carry over to the next object or idea?
The idea, I think, that resonates in my work and a lot of the artists here are that growth is painful. You'll see the idea of dreams deferred. You'll see the idea of challenge in order to grow, in order to overcome. And I would say that that's kind of a through line or a thread that I'm noticing in a lot of the artists' work here. But this seems like a very interesting point where a lot of things are kind of bubbling and brewing, and it's just exciting to be a part of that energy.
There's always this sense that we are connected in some way, whether it be, you know, genetically or scientifically or even just through the everyday objects that we use, you know, in our different spaces. You know, Opa-Locka is doing something that's unique and special. Not only for Opa-Locka, but I think for the broader community.
To learn more about the Art of Transformation events in Opa-Locka, visit opalockaart.com.
You don't necessarily know if you're looking at a plant or if you're looking at glass. You're required to take a more careful look. And that's really great for both an art person as well as a plant person, because you're forced to look at things that perhaps you would have walked by.
30 years after the Miami Generation exhibition debuted in South Florida, the NSU Museum of Art Fort Lauderdale is expanding upon and revisiting featured works by Cuban exile artists. Some were among the first wave of exiles to receive an arts education in the United States. The Miami Generation Revisited is a showcase of the new as well as a re-examination of the original nine artists' contributions. Take a look.
It seems like when people think of Cuba and Cuban art, they always think that they're going to be looking at still lifes of mangoes and paintings of Carmen Miranda, who was not even Cuban. So when they come here, they will see that the Cubans are not afraid to face and portray themes that are mature, that are sophisticated, and that require a little thinking. The title of the exhibition is The Miami Generation Revisited. The exhibition was first mounted with the original nine people back in 1983. And then, of course, since then, the original curator passed away, and three of the artists also died of AIDS.
It's very sobering to walk about this exhibition and see so many missing. And at the same time, I smile when I see some of the work, because these are works that I had seen before. So it's very special that at least we're showing together, you know, in this particular occasion, 31 years after the original exhibition.
The goal was to bring together a group of nine artists who were of Cuban origins. They were all born in Cuba, and most of them came to the United States when they were teenagers. What they share in common was that they developed as artists in the United States, being brought up in exile.
Supposedly we were, you know, handpicked, we like the best in the city at that time for Cuban painters. So we traveled to Washington, to Philadelphia, to Puerto Rico. So it was a very nice experience.
Then it broke new ground because we have never had an exhibition of a group of Cuban Americans. So like I said, it was something that it was coming and in a way overdue, like this exhibition is.
So I always find my personal history permeating the work I do. The genesis of this piece and the series titled Wind Paintings was the nuclear explosion in Chernobyl. That was in April 1986. And I was in Paris at the time working. All of a sudden, there's this radioactive cloud coming in, carrying these radioactive particles. The idea of the wind and the Chernobyl accident totally changed my work from mostly abstract aerial views of landscapes to a more referential, almost ecological type of consciousness. The wind, all of a sudden, and landscape in general, has been romanticized by many artists since the beginning. And how can we go from here when man does something to nature and then nature turns against itself? The relationship in nature as we know today, and what, as an artist, what do I do about this? How can I cannot romanticize it anymore.
I was born and raised in a house that had views to the ocean, two blocks away from three different streets. So that line with the Sea of the Caribbean, it was a constant in my years growing up. I've had several, you know, like periods in my career, and this was architectural scenarios that evoked, you know, the architecture of Cuba and the Caribbean, connected to Cuba through the colors and through some of the architectural elements, but not exactly Cuba. I did the flooding using the symbolism of, you know, when you're covered with water, it represents a big tragedy, but it also represents rebirth and purification, what we have gone through.
We have the work of Emilio Falero. What he liked to do was to bring together works of art by different artists from different generations and establish a dialogue between the past and the present.
Because there's a big enthusiasm for anything done in Cuba, but they ignore, once the artist leaves Cuba, it's no longer important. So I keep telling him, look and see what's done outside Cuba, you know, because, I mean, Cuban art can be done outside Cuba too.
You can look at it as a family reunion.
It was an opportunity to meet them all again and to see their development. It's been 30 years, so the work in all of us has evolved and changed. So it was very nice a very nice experience. I would say even better than the first one.
Each of them somehow whistles a different tune. There's very little repetition here. They are all originals, and what they do is that they bring together aspects from North American culture and Cuban culture.
Something was brewing at the time, and I'm happy to be part of it, and still are. This is home. I'm a Miami boy.
For more information about the Miami Generation Revisited, visit moafl.org.
When there's the least amount of separation between me and my work is when I just get the most honest results. I think to create the best work I possibly can, I have to literally like turn myself inside out.
The Fairchild Tropical Botanic Garden in Coral Gables has once again teamed up with artist Dale Chihuly to create stunning installations. A few of these glass innovations may cause you to think twice about which is born of fire or sunshine. Join us as we tour the grounds, spotting striking art amongst nature's beauty.
We are here at Fairchild Tropical Botanic Garden, considered to be one of the greatest tropical gardens in the world. And it sits right here in Miami-Dade County. So it's this great gem of a botanical rich heritage. And what we try and do is really create a hub for culture, science, education, and conservation right here and within this wonderful, magical garden so that everybody can understand how important it is to conserve tropical plants, especially within an urban environment, as well as create cultural richness that allow people to connect with art and nature and music and nature and everything related to the gardens as a muse. Fairchild started its art program in 2005, and our very first art exhibit was Dale Chihuly. And it seemed very appropriate to celebrate our 10th anniversary by bringing Dale Chihuly back to Fairchild. And what makes his medium, which is glass, so wonderful within a garden setting is that it's very malleable, it's very soft. Glass is not soft, but the forms themselves can be very soft. And so you get these great, bold designs, and then you also get these very organic and sinewy pieces that just feel like they're oftentimes considered plants. You don't necessarily know if you're looking at a plant or if you're looking at glass. You're required to take a more careful look. And that's really great for both an art person as well as a plant person, because you're forced to look at things that perhaps you would have walked by. And it allows us to perhaps highlight certain things on a more subjective level. Dale Chihuly is considered the foremost glass artist in the world, an artist of all artists, and a true lover of his craft. And so he has worked with the medium of glass for over 45 years. In fact, this installation represents every series that he's ever had. But more than anything, he's a creative spirit. And he's always pushing himself, and he's always pushing his team, and always bending things in a way that perhaps can't be done, and then finding a way to get that across beautifully and poetically. And he always describes his style as one very elemental: gravity, fire, oxygen. And you have those elements, and you can create pretty much anything, as he says it. So right behind me is a polyvitro chandelier, one of Dale's not glass sculptures. And polyvitro is really just Italian for polyurethane glass. As you can see, this piece is quite large. It's probably 25 feet large, and something that big would be exorbitantly heavy in glass. So he created polyvitro as a way to be able to do these great grand scale sculptures, but still have them be practical. What you have over to my right, when you pan over, you're going to see the beautiful Sol del Citron, which is a piece that was made specifically for Fairchild. And what it does is that it really is very sensitive to this beautiful allée. And allée is a French word for alley, essentially. And the garden designers wanted the sense of mystery. So you're walking down this dark allée, dappled light, and then you open up this great big keyhole. And that keyhole is bright and lit and sun-stricken. And so you get this sense of expansiveness. You're gonna get pieces that sit within the air garden that are very, you know, tough, very rigid, very stout. And they're designed to look very much like an air garden, very much in keeping with xeriscaping. And then you get into the rainforest, which is significantly more romantic and sensual, and you get pieces that move, and pieces that are much more discreet and less aggressive and less angry, for lack of a better word. The Nejima floats sit within the Victoria Pool, and what makes them really special is that they're the largest blown glass piece that Dale produces. And they're incredibly hard to blow. I think the statistic is something like 85% shatter. So the success rate of blowing these massive orbs is really not great. But it's worth the wait because the results are so spectacular. The daytime exhibition is really quite striking because what you get is this great relationship between plant and human interaction and glass interaction, art interaction, very obviously. And except perhaps in the rainforest where you have a little more, you know, organic touches. But you definitely feel the perspectives and you definitely feel embeddedness of the glass within the collections of plants, which is really quite remarkable. But the night exhibitions are really quite a different feel because what you get is this luminescence within the garden, within the sculptures, and they glow in the most spectacular way. You have to see it to be able to describe it. It's not enough to see it in the daytime, and it's not enough to see it at nighttime. You have to see the whole thing because it's a 24-hour experience for certain. The Bailey Palm Glade is really the most formal spot in the entire garden. The garden was designed in an east-west access, and you have tuckaways, you have less formality, and then you have great formality within the Bailey Palm Glade. Then you have this great long aisle, a great long view that opens up to the lowlands and onto the lakes of the reflective blades of the palms. So the Bailey Palm Glade is just this incredible work structured within a lot of stone, a lot of bend, a lot of softness, and you have a big blue orb overhead, very soft, very rounded, in keeping with the sensitivity and the lack of straight lines of the Bailey Palm Glade. Dale is also a masterful canvas artist, and we have a great installation of his work within the new building that we just opened in early December. And you can find about 15 or so of his works in there, as well as smaller pieces that are much more portable and gracing people's homes nowadays. That gallery is always open, and it's really quite beautiful. There's an introductory video of Dale's work. It's just a really nice way to introduce yourself to him, to his installation, to his thought process. You see behind the scenes footage of him blowing glass. The process is really quite fascinating when then you see the end result. I think it would be fair to say that the overwhelming response to this exhibition is, oh my God, this is the greatest thing I've ever seen. For 10 years since the very first Chihuly exhibition of Fairchild, there hasn't been a day that's gone by where somebody hasn't asked, is Dale Chihuly's work here? When is Chihuly coming back to Fairchild? That's how much it resonated with people, how connected they felt to those works. And so in general, it's exuberance, it's joy, it's this sense of wonderment that only a great work of art and only a great garden, perhaps together, can give you a sense of things are right. All in all, it's been incredibly well received.
To find out more about the Chihuly exhibition, visit fairchildgarden.org. Thanks for joining us this week. Let Art Loft inspire your creativity every day. Stay connected to us via Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. And don't forget, you can visit wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. I'm Kaylin James reminding you to stay creative. Bye. Luxurious. Looking at my hair, I'm kind of like, darn, bleh. That was bad from the beginning. 30 years after the Miami, I suck. Woo, thank you.
Jesus, thank you, Lord.
See the slow smile. Hey, look at that lens, almost done, ow.
Join.
Come on out. See the art. Okay, so separate, articulate, enunciate, celebrate. Yay, close it. Ow, ow.
Chihuly, I'm in love with Chihuly.
Kids are so mean. Don't put that on the poop. Rap. Used to think, baby. That's a wrap.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.